Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Welcome everyone to our September 8th meeting at Alamance County Commissioners. Please join me in the invocation. Father God, we do thank you, Lord, for just another beautiful day outside. And Lord, we just thank you for the many blessings you've bestowed on each one of us. Father, as we come to you now, Lord, I just pray that you'd guide and direct this board as we attend to the business of serving those that we serve. Father, these things I do pray in your holy name. Amen.
Amen.
Stand for a pledge, please.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Please be seated. We have one public speaker today, Mr. Gearhart. Welcome, sir.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thanks for your time today, Commissioners. My name is Jamie Gearhart. I work directly for Sheets Incorporated in their real estate department. And it's nice to be here today to describe an event that we're having in our future here in Alamance County. I'm sure you're well aware of Sheets and appreciate the support from Alamance County in the past, but perhaps you may not be aware that our proudest accomplishment has been the founding of our own nonprofit organization, Sheets Family Charities. Back in 1992, by local store employees, the charity was founded wanting to help local children. The mission of the charity is, and let me read this part, is to provide support, hope, joy, and happiness to children in need in the community Sheets operates in. So each year, store-level employees raise money, corporate raises money through vendors, the IT department has a large prize at Palooza. We do this, and to date, the charity has raised over $18 million and helped more than 85,000 children. What the money goes for is twofold. One is a December event where local kids selected by, in this case, the Alamance Salvation Army, they identify the kids who are in need. We then shop for their wish lists. We wrap the gifts and throw a big party for them the second week in December. Now, across the six states that Sheets operates in, there's like 100 Sheets Family Charities Christmas parties the second week in December. 2 years ago, it was at the Salvation Army here in Alamance County. Last year, it was at our distribution center, now that we had that opening. So the local stores, Graham, Mebane, Burlington, have their assigned 15 to 16 kids, and they had this great party. As we grow in North Carolina, we've decided to host a cornhole tournament to benefit Sheets Family Charities. We have 78 stores in the state. We have a distribution center. We said, darn it, we need to have a local event versus a corporate event. And I have a flyer that I'd like to pass out or hand up if appropriate. It's a double elimination cornhole tournament, September 26th at our distribution center from 3 to 9. We do have a couple sponsors, but instead of a corporate golf outing, it's more an event that's open to the public, which is why I'm here today. It's a large family type atmosphere. We've had a good response from customers, from different city departments in attendance, sponsorship, participation, and we think it's really something. It's time now that we have so many stores to do something that will again help local children. So that's why I'm here today. Like I said, I can hand out the flyers, but otherwise, thank you for your time. I can answer any questions about the event or the charity itself.
Thank you, Mr. Gilmore. You have this flyer, please, sir.
Yes, sir.
And what Saturday was that? I saw it in the paper, but
September 26th.
September 26th. Okay.
It's something new for us. Like I said, we said, darn it, we have enough stores, we have enough mass in here finally that we need to do something here to add money to the corporate chair.
Well, thank you for what y'all do.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Right.
Thank you.
Thanks, sir. Any other commissioners' responses? Right, next, we have the approval of the agenda. Do I have a motion to approve of the agenda?
I so move.
Second.
All right. Motion second. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. Consent agenda. Any items on the consent agenda any board member would like to have pulled from the consent agenda?
I move the consent agenda be approved.
All right.
I'll second that.
Have a motion second approval of the consent agenda. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. Next, we have the presentation of the ABSS strategic plan update. Dr. Harrison, welcome, sir.
Thank you, Chairman Engel and Commissioners and Manager Honeycutt. We have been working hard on that strategic plan for better than a year now. We feel that we're making some progress. We had a good session with our community stakeholders close to a month ago, and Mr. Honeycutt suggested that I provide that same presentation to the commissioners, and I'm hoping it will appear on the screen pretty soon so I have something to talk about. Can I do this here?
Yeah.
First of all, I think it's always important for us to stand up and say, when we're talking about what our school system will become, is we're going to become a system that is known nationally for innovation and the levels of our student achievement. And you folks stepped to the table, and I thank you again for the investment that you're making in public education, and I can assure you that there will be dividends paid on that investment that you've made. This community came together and did a wonderful job putting this plan together that will lead us towards the realization of the vision. We're very intentional about everything that we do connecting to this this vision. We want every classroom to be the type of classroom that any parent would want their child, that we have exemplary teaching. And the teaching's important, but what's most important is that there's exemplary learning. And so that's goal number one. Master plan for specialized programs. We realize that all students have a variety of needs, interests, and talents. And we need to understand that one size doesn't fit all. So I think you'll see a lot of varieties of programs and offerings in our schools. A written five-year facilities plan, and many of you have played a major role in our beginning that. We put together the task force. I think the task force did great work. We had an update for them a month ago, and we're going to continue to working and meeting on a quarterly basis. We want world-class teacher working conditions. Anyone who has ever heard me talk about this endeavor of education has heard me say that at the end of the day, it comes down to competent, caring teachers working in the classroom. The nature of the work of teachers has changed dramatically over the years, since the time I was a student, since the time I was a teacher. But what hasn't changed is the fact that we need great teachers working with our children. And we need to create the conditions in which teachers will prefer to come and work in ABSS rather than going east or west. Compensation for building level employees, that's another piece of it, but I think the two of those go together, a fair, competitive compensation model, and we, thanks to you, we were able to increase our supplement for our building level employees. We're able to increase our salary rate for our bus drivers, and so we're moving in a good direction there. And then the final is classroom and school support, that we're asking teachers to do more than we've ever asked teachers to do in the past. And we need to make sure that we provide the supports to make that happen. You know, too often we just sit around and talk about standards. Let's raise the standards, but don't do anything differently. So if you don't give the kid a new pair of shoes, he's not going to be able to jump over that higher bar. So we want to make sure our teachers have support. I'm just going to go quickly towards the outcomes. And with the goal number one, teaching and instructional leadership, we've established very ambitious five-year plans for benchmarks that this is where we're going to be. We're looking at two things. We're looking at proficiency, and we're looking at growth. And the proficiency is simply the percentage of students scoring grade level. And I think growth is a more accurate measure of the impact that schools are having and classrooms are having on children, because it's a measure of where children are when they start and where they are at the end of the year. We've defined standards for exemplary teaching, and we want to make sure that every child every day is in a classroom that he or she knows that they're cared for, that they're being taught to a specific objective, that they're engaged. We learn by doing. We don't learn by sitting and listening. That they receive immediate and specific feedback, and they're taught at the appropriate level of rigor. We want all of our youngsters to be challenged. So we have those five markers that we expect to see in all of our classrooms every day. And we also created a professional development framework that can provide support for that. And you know, heretofore, the superintendents and principals used to always tell teachers to make sure they differentiate instruction for their students. But when we provide instruction for teachers, we feed everybody out of the same spoon. And it doesn't work that way. We've got teachers who have needs in a particular area. We've got other teachers who have needs in another area. And so what we have is it's a menu, so to speak. It's a combination of blended that they can do some things online. They don't have to show up. But it's a really intensive coaching model, being there with the teachers on a regular basis, helping and supporting them. The second goal, our master plan for specialized programs. We have a number of specialized programs in effect, but we simply want to be very systemic and intentional about that, and how are we growing those things. And basically what we've done this year is we've added an A-plus arts program at North Graham Elementary School, and we're looking at our six high school feeder zones, and we have a series of three models that we want each of those models to be present somewhere in each of those attendance zones. So North Graham has our first cultural arts program. We anticipate expanding that into one of the other districts next year. We also have our language immersion programs. We expanded that to East Lawn this year, so now we have, you know, a language immersion program at South Graham, at Elon, at Smith, and at Eastern, and we anticipate to grow next year in either the Southern district or who are we missing? With the Cummings district. No, Cummings is there with Eastern.
Yeah.
We'll have six of them in 2 years. The Virtual Academy, we began this last year, that our students would take half the day at CTEC and half the day online. Now we're in the process of making that completely virtual, that students will not have to show up, and the board is presently adopting a policy that will enable us to reach out to our homeschool community and provide some quality education, provide some courses that the homeschool providers may or may not be able to provide. So that's really going to grow. We've began the early college. We've had a middle college for about 5 years that served 11th and 12th graders on the campus of ACC, and ACC has just been an incredible partner, and this year we have 40 ninth graders on the campus of and we've got to find a way to expand that program, and they don't have space at ACC, but we had about 200 parents express an interest in their child going to the early college. About 120 met the criteria to go, and so we had a lottery, and 40 people got to go, and 80 people we had to say no, and I have a hard time saying no to 80 people, so we're searching for a way to expand that. And then Global Gateway Schools, that's in concert with our immersion programs, is just a global theme in those schools as well. And it's pretty exciting. Facilities plan, you guys know a lot about this. We put $1 million worth into painting and repairs this summer. We had our last task force meeting at Graham Middle School, and it was night and day between those of you who visited Graham last year. We also came to you to free up a lot more bond money last month. And we're going to come to you after the board meets at our work session with about $500,000 from either bond or some of the money that's already out there, but you guys have to free up for technology purposes. So we feel that are working hard right now on a redistricting plan that I plan to share with the board at its October meeting. I meet regularly with Mr. Honeycutt and your planner to talk about what our needs are there. So we're actually our first year number, our first 10-day numbers are a little bit higher than the state anticipated. Not much, so they're pretty close to be on target. So all the figures that we're looking at with our projections have held true the 2 years that I've been here. We know, and again, we're in close contact with the county about potential growth. World-class teacher working conditions. We've implemented a teacher leadership academy. We had about 50 of our teachers volunteer to spend an hour and a half after school five times during the year just hearing me and some of our colleagues talking about our culture and leadership and what we want to do. And then one of the most exciting things that I've been involved in is the Educator Leadership Academy. I'm sorry, that will be starting year two. The most exciting thing that I've been involved in is the Teacher Leadership Academy, which is being sponsored by Impact Alamance. We have 50 teachers, 31 from each of the 36 schools, 14 others. They spend a day, a good portion of the day, somewhere in the community, and then we kind of relate what's happening in the community to our work that we're doing. I believe tomorrow we're going to be at Social Services, if I'm not mistaken. Yes.
And health.
And health. Okay, great. So we're looking forward to that. We've been to Saxapaha, we've been to Glen Raven, we've been to the hospital, and the feedback that we're getting from our teachers is just incredible. And in addition to providing that leadership academy, those teachers have the opportunity to apply for grants. They're going to award somewhere between 5 and 10 grants, up to $20,000. And I know they have been working on those, and we expect to announce those grant recipients at our board meeting on September 14th, or whenever our board meeting is. We've decreased class size in selected grade levels. We've differentiated our teacher allotment formula based on percentages of students having free and reduced lunch. So again, we think those are some things that create the type of conditions where we feel people will want to work and they'll choose us other than surrounding counties. I've already talked about the compensation for building level employees. We have that 5-year plan to be competitive with the folks on the east and the west of us. You know, we've looked at numbers. Our turnover rate is a little bit higher than the state average, and a good percentage of those who leave us are simply moving one county east or one county west. And we need to fix that. Classroom supports, we've made a significant investment in new math books for grades 6 through 12. We had to use local dollars to do that. And again, we appreciate you helping, because the General Assembly has consistently cut the textbook allotment over the past few years, and who knows what's going to happen when they adjourn in December. I know Commissioner Chairman Engler is happy he's here in Alamance rather than in Raleigh right now. Our board increased the classroom supply allotment by $8 per child, which is significant when you're looking at a school of 1,200 kids. Again, we've also the professional development framework that I mentioned, we think that's a support as well. And that's it. I know my vice chair is speaking after me, and I didn't want to take too much time with him waiting. So we just thought it would be good for me to take 10-15 minutes and let you know that we're moving forward, that we are most appreciative of the support that you've provided, and we understand that with that support comes an awesome responsibility, and we anticipate delivering. Any questions?
We thank you. Number one, for questioning, we thank you, Dr. Harrison, for this report. And also, I'd like to welcome School Board Chair Thompson and Vice Chair Van Pelt, and also Member Tony Rose here today to our meeting. Questions from the commissioners?
Well, I'd just like to say that I appreciate this update, and I think that the plan is a good plan, and I appreciate the way you're going about implementing it. I serve as the liaison from this board to the Board of Education, and I can assure you that Dr. Harrison and his staff do an amazing amount of work on implementing these things, and there's always great discussion and challenges to some of these by the members of the Board of Education, but it seems to be a really good process, and I think this communication is very helpful.
Well, I like the way that everything has been outlined, and you know where you're going instead of just kind of shooting at the stars, and I think we'll see results in the long run.
Of course, one of our primary responsibilities is capital and these buildings, and I'm getting, I'm having teachers and administrators and parents and even kids that are excited because of what they're seeing in their schools in terms of the, what was that number in terms of change orders that had been, wasn't it 1160? Does that?
It's a bunch. More than I can
count. Had been done. Yes.
Have been completed since this endeavor was started. I know all the tile was ripped up out of, Judge, you was concerned about the asbestos over at Williams High School. That's a done deal, you know, now. And I could just go on all over the school system, and the amount of work's been done.
And I think we saw a positive thing when we went to Graham Middle School with kids. They were excited to be there, and I think it just reflects to everything.
A lot of work to be done.
Yes.
A lot of work to be done.
I understand. Any further comments or questions?
Yeah, I have. I think we had somewhere around $6 million for several years, and nothing was done with that money until Dr. Harrison came in. and took over in the last year, the school system has been moving like crazy. Yeah. And I want to thank you for your leadership, Doctor, because I couldn't understand why that money was not being spent, and we kept getting nothing but complaints about problems, facility problems, quite frankly, within the school system. Yeah. So you woke somebody up.
No, I think we have really good people. Our board is.
You mean to imply you didn't?
It's not been Bill Harrison that's made anything happen.
I think it is.
It's a lot of great people. It's a board that's together and focused on the right thing, and I think we're just all really aligned, and the entire community coming together. I think the Strive Together initiative that we're embarking on, I think, has the potential to even tighten up those relationships. Those are already very good relationships, and make sure that we're intentional and more efficient and effective. But thank you, Commissioner.
Thank you for what you do.
Sure,
thank you.
Thank you. Very good.
All right. Next, we have Mr. Van Pelt, Peggy Hamlet, John Cox, Juvenile Crime Prevention Council Annual Report. Welcome.
Thank you. We got to read all that today, Steve.
Can you get all that done?
This is a copy of our. I'll just lay one here for Linda.
Thank you.
No, I'm going to try to do this rather quickly. I think trying to follow Bill Harrison is a tough act to follow because he's the master of the PowerPoint. He can get it down and get it done. Here it is. Just to give you a brief history of JCPC, it was formed in 1997 through the Governor's Commission on Juvenile Crime, and as a result of this, we had the Juvenile Justice Reform Act adopted, and this formed a Juvenile Crime Prevention Council in every county. The meat and potatoes of this is North Carolina Department of Public Safety is partnering with us here at our local JCPC, and we've got lots of community leaders locally that work with the JCPC. You all have the final say of who goes on the board. We have some that are appointed directly by you. I'm one of those. And others because of the way the law is written. We have, and I'll go into that a little bit later, but we meet 10 times a year, and the Department of Public Safety allots $23 million statewide for that. Of that, we get $330,000. Now, the next three slides just tell you who's on the JCPC, who's ready, and we have several members here today or someone there that may be a designee. But Peggy is our chief court counselor, and she's based right downstairs in this building. And she has three counties, Chatham and Orange, as well as us. And John Cox is our incoming chair for JCPC. The reason I'm doing the presentation because I'm the one that I was responsible for the plan that we'll be under this year. Next year it'll be John. And we've got members from the faith community, mental health, district court judge, substance abuse counselor, county commissioner, someone representing Bill Harrison, business community. And here's the members at large that are appointed directly by the county commissioners. Now, our local plan, and that's what I gave you. juvenile crime in this county seems to be decreasing from the previous year. And if we compare the stats to fiscal year 2014-15, we're encouraged with the following. And you can see that intake, the number that went to intake dropped from 308 to 240. Complaints dropped significantly. Juveniles approved for court dropped a little bit. Juveniles placed in detention dropped. School-related offenses dropped significantly. Gang offenses dropped significantly. And I just might want to say this. When it says 17 juveniles on gang offenses, I think, Peggy, you said that was, what, one or two or just a few individuals that were charged several times?
Yes, it was maybe just a few juveniles charged with multiple offenses.
And our YDC, youth detention centers, the commitment dropped from 6 to 2, and that's a very expensive when they have to be placed outside the county in one of these centers. We're using a program called Act Together in Greensboro, and it provides an alternative to detention through the Act Together, and it's for juveniles who needs out-of-home placement and are low risk to the county. And we appreciate the commissioners and the county manager working with us on this. It actually saves the state money. It doesn't save us money, but we can use our juvenile detention money plus $2 for every student night that goes over there. And we feel like this is better than going to juvenile detention. I want to point out a couple of big things that's been big this year. One is our faith-based committee. We held the second juvenile court date for community members, and we try to target ministers and youth directors from our local churches. What happens here is that when a kid gets in trouble, sometimes the first person that knows about it after the parents is the minister. And if the ministers know, can help parents through this, through the process of what it's like to go to juvenile court or appear before Peggy and her staff downstairs, that sometimes can do a lot to allay the situation. This committee also developed a mentoring guide for churches and trained clergy and other community members on how to use the guide. And they're working on more and better things as we speak. Realize your potential is a committee that we formed, and what we've been doing is working with Burlington Recreation and Parks and the Teen to Teen Theater to produce some videos that target issues that face teenagers and try to keep them from getting a criminal record once they turn 16. And we've also, and hopefully to hear something next week, we applied for a grant through Impact Alamance to help with this process. And here, I think I mentioned this, our local JCPC sponsors seven programs with $330,218 from the state and a 30% in-kind match from county government and the community. And this is a list of programs. There's a full description of the programs in the in the document I gave you. These statistics, I think, show that how JCPC is helping our community. If you start looking at fiscal year 2004 and follow up the chart, you can see how the referrals have decreased over the past 12 years. That's a 56% drop during this period, and this is consistent among racial groups, genders, and it mirrors statewide statistics. This does compare Alamance County and the state per thousand of delinquency rate. And while we are not yet quite at the point we'd like to be to meet the state average. We're off by about two points. You can see we've managed to close the gap over the last few years. And we're very proud of that. What can we do to help? Well, let people know what you know about JCPC, what you've heard today. Let law enforcement and decision makers know that you support programs that are proven to reduce juvenile crime, and support our youth by supporting all programs that help our youth become good citizens. And that's the schools, churches, community-based recreation, art-based program, scouts, and other programs sponsored by JCPC and law enforcement. And of course, the next question is why? And I think we all know the answer. These are our citizens of tomorrow that are going to be here taking care of us as we get older, and they're going to be our leaders, our workers, our parents, taxpayers. And so we will, if they come up the right, raise a child the right way, they'll be good adults. But I think the next thing is very important too. I've seen some mighty good teamwork across the community. The schools can't do it by themselves. JCPC can't do it by themselves. Commissioners, social services, health department, everybody. We have to work together. And the more we work together, I think we're going to get better results. And I think this 12-year drop that we've seen, I think that's a result of a lot of good teamwork across the community. So I'm through, and if you have any questions, I'm going to refer those to John and Peggy. No, we'll try to answer your questions.
How many churches do we have involved in the program now? Do we have a rough estimate?
What, four that people that come from the faith-based every meeting?
Well, we've got a good many churches that are involved directly in that. Matter of fact, there's several of us, several groups, the Closing the Achievement Gap group. I know Stephanie Braxton, she was looking. The schools have a list. There was another list that was generated. I can't remember who generated it, but we're going to try to put together a big master list. It might not be JCPC, it does, but we're trying to see that as who's helping out where, particularly in the schools, and trying to answer some questions when somebody calls and says, we want to help. We are looking at that, but I couldn't tell you exactly, Dan, on how many churches we have involved, but there is quite a few.
I think we had 16 churches represented at our juvenile day before.
They're very active,
right?
Faith-based community.
Something like that. And the year before we did it, it was a different group of churches, mm-hmm. for the most part. So the faith-based community is doing a really fine job in trying to get the message out and listen to what the church's concerns are.
And I think Larry Brown's been instrumental.
Larry Brown's been really instrumental. Matter of fact, Larry
Brown, he's a ball of fire, so
the National Juvenile Justice Conference was held in Greensboro, I think it was January, February, wasn't it, Peggy? And Larry did a presentation over there at the National Conference.
Yeah.
And I called it, and it was excellent. He's a lot of fun to listen to.
I don't really have any questions. I just want to thank Steve for the many 6 years, I think you said.
I think 6 years.
He's been heading that committee, and to thank him for all the
hard
work.
And I'm still going to be there. I've got a year and a half left on my term, and who knows, I may want to up again.
Well, there you go. Well, I thank you, Steve, for all that hard work. And it's just amazing the collaboration that goes on, because you go to I'm on a lot of other committee and meetings, things I go to, but this is like everybody in the community is involved in, and I think that's why we will see more results as we move forward. So. Right.
Further comments or questions? Thank you, Steve. Right. Appreciate it.
Right, next we have the, discussion of stepping up initiative mental
Illness Committee. Commissioner Byrd.
Thank you, Dan. At our August 3rd meeting, we adopted a resolution to more of a call to action to deal with this nationwide problem of increasing population of people with mental illness in our jails. Across the country, there are 2 million people with serious mental illness booked into our jails each year. 13% of the North Carolina prison population require mental illness interventions, and 3/4 of those have co-concurrent substance abuse issues. Adults with mental illness tend to stay longer in our jails, and they risk much higher recidivism rates. Easy for you to say. There are more people with mental illness in our jails than are in psychiatric institutions around the country. And our county jails spend 2 to 3 times as much on adults with mental illness than those without mental illness because of their treatment needs. Jails are generally an unsafe environment for people with mental illness. And without appropriate treatment and services, people with mental illness tend to be criminalized, even though their behaviors that got them arrested had no criminal intent. So this results in tragic outcomes for themselves and their families and in our communities. And the kind of mental illness that we're talking about kind of comes down to 4 main ones, and that would be schizophrenia, bipolar disease, severe depression, and post-traumatic stress disorder. So what our call to action did was to form a task force to delve into this. And this is all being put together by the National Association of Counties, who's really spearheading this initiative across the country. This is an organization that represents county commissioners all across the country, county managers. And then the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners is behind this as well. Along with NACO, the American Psychiatric Association's Foundation is behind this. The Council of State Governments Justice Center. Lots of other organizations are behind it as well, such as NAMI, the National Association for Mental Illness. So what's being recommended is that we have a task force to be formed in our local community. And there's a 6-step process that this task force would undertake. First, it would collect and review the prevalence numbers and assess individual needs. And then it would examine treatment and service capacity in our community, policy barriers, funding barriers to minimize contact with the justice system with these people with mental illness. The third step would be to develop a plan with measurable outcomes. So the first thing was to get the task force going, and then to collect and review the prevalence, then examine treatment and service capacity, then to develop a plan with measurable outcomes, then to implement research-based approaches to deal with this issue, and then create a process to track the progress. So what would be recommended as the composition of such a task force would be somebody representing the Board of Commissioners, the sheriff or one of the sheriff's designees, the DA's office, our area local law enforcement agencies, all the police departments ought to be represented. Maybe a judge or somebody from the court system, perhaps a magistrate, and then others in the advocacy arena, like somebody from NAMI, National Association of Mental Illness, Cardinal Innovation Healthcare Solutions, and then maybe a couple of actual providers of mental health services. Is it RHI that contracts with Cardinal? The one over on
RHA.
Thank you, Susan. And maybe somebody from Cone Health, Alamance Regional, to really delve into this and see what we can do. And I know I've talked to Sheriff Johnson about this, and Sheriff, you might speak to the prevalence in our own jail about this issue and how many people we have.
Yes, sir. Today, I think we had 457 inmates in jail, and probably, I would say, anywhere to 60-75% probably would not be in there if they were getting their medication or had the proper treatment for mental health in our jail. Yesterday we had an individual who was running naked, crazy, went to a house, tried to break in the house, and in jail now because we had no other alternative. That individual definitely had a mental health condition. and we need to look at that very hard, Mr. Burton, in helping in the jails. Every sheriff in this state, this has been a topic for the North Carolina Sheriff Association for years, and finally, somebody's beginning to listen. Good. And hopefully we can make things better for those that are mentally handicapped.
And NACO offers a toolkit to help, so we don't have to reinvent the wheel to do this. There are a lot of things going on across the country that we can learn about and borrow. I think probably the biggest things are to come up with diversion tactics and linkages to services out in the community to somehow divert people from getting into the whole criminal justice system to begin with. But
I wonder if there's been a study done in terms of the increase of people that are incarcerated with mental health issues since the local mental health agencies were done away with and they consolidated to these large local management entities.
I would like to speak to that.
Yes, sir.
You're doggone right it has. When the state turned it over to private entities,
right,
it has. It's really been tough.
And now, Sheriff, if I'm not mistaken, of course, through NAMI, and we thank them for that, but you have the CIT training now.
Yes, sir.
Crisis intervention training for the officers. And that started about the time that they combined the local mental health agencies into these LMEs, these large LMEs. And the reasoning for that is, as law enforcement, we're going to see more folks with mental illness out on the streets. We're going to be coming in contact with law enforcement. And it's a crying shame what we've done in terms of that. Any further comments?
I'd like to ask Bob, have you considered maybe getting one of our legislators on this committee?
That would be recommended, yes.
The state does a lot of funding that they took away, and
right.
They can carry it back to Raleigh as they gain knowledge of the situation.
That's true. It is recommended to have a state policymaker on this group, yeah. And maybe somebody from Department of Social Services as well. And so I was thinking that maybe we could ask Craig and I have talked about this, to help facilitate pulling together the right individual folks.
And Mr. Chairman, I would like to thank Commissioner Byrd for his work on this. Many times we pass resolutions that are just in support. This resolution really required us to do an action item and to formulate a committee and to really delve into the issue and how it affects our jail locally. So I appreciate Commissioner Byrd taking this on as a project as well. Yeah.
Further comments, discussion? Then by consensus, I'd like to just you continue, Mr. Byrd, to work with our county manager on the committee. And by consensus, is that okay with everyone here? By consensus, it is. And we'll get this committee together.
Thank you.
All right, next we have approval to apply for a recreational trail program grant. Brian Baker. Welcome, Brian, director of our Parks and Recreation.
Yes, sir. I've come before you today on behalf of the Recreation and Parks Department to seek permission to apply for a grant from the North Carolina State Trails Recreational Trail Program. This is a grant program that we've used with some frequency over the years. The purpose of the grant would be to assist us with the development of Saxbaugh Island, which some of you may remember was donated to the county in 2014 by Waste Industries. We are in the middle of apparently a long series of public meetings to determine what the community wants to do out there. Several things we know for sure they want, and those are the things that we are seeking grant funding to build. This grant would help us build approximately 4 miles of trails that would connect from Saxbaugh Dam upstream of the island all the way down to the Alamance County landfill. That would be part of the Harbor Trail, Mountains to Sea Trail. Once we finish building that, this grant would also help us build a trailhead and some much-needed parking in the area to get folks out on those trails. The community has had a lot of input. The number one and two things they wanted were parking and trails, so that's what we're doing. But they had another long list. They want a natural playground and some outdoor meeting space, and we're working to accommodate those needs. We don't have a final site plan yet, but we will share that with you when we finalize that based on their interest. But this is step one of development of that island. We have received consent of the Recreation and Parks Commission, and this grant does not require a cash match from the county.
So move.
I'll second it, but I did have one question.
The motion and a second.
That's all you had to do.
I should have just led with that. I saved it for the end.
That was quick, Mr. Berg. Excuse me, were you finished?
I'm done.
All right, sir. Berg, I was confused when you described this because you said you'd use the money for the trailhead and the trails, but it didn't sound like any of it was going to be on the island itself. So
that's part of it.
It will be as well.
Part of the trail is on the island?
Yeah, it's a trail network which does go north and south along the river, but there's about 2 miles of that is on the island itself.
Brian, didn't you have the preliminary kind of what was happening that we saw at the meeting that maybe you could send to the commissioners?
Absolutely.
To let them look
I'd be happy to
kind of a proposal that they're looking at.
Sure.
But yeah, trying to get feedback from the community.
Got some good ideas. I'll be happy to share our preliminary site plan with you guys.
Yeah.
Sounds good. All right. We've heard. We have a motion from Commissioner Smith, seconded by Commissioner Byrd. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Uh-huh.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
Appreciate it. Next, we have Susan Osborne, Director of DSS, Alamance Alliance, final report.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So, much like Brian, just ask your permission to apply for that grant. We stood here in January of 2008 and asked for that same permission. And I'm here to report today that exciting things have happened over the last 7 years. And Connie and Gary are going to go through that. But I just wanted to take a minute. You know, we embarked on this as county government because we were at social services seeing kids coming into the foster care system. You heard about JCPC, kids, you know, our detention rate, all of those things. And we said, so we're pulling kids out of the river. Let's go downstream and see why they're falling in. And that's really been our focus. We've accomplished what you're about to hear with strong community partners. I think Eddie, Commissioner Boswell mentioned that just now, that this has been collaborative. And even though county government has been the infrastructure for that, and you should be very proud that we've offered that infrastructure when you hear these accomplishments. It has been a community effort. The exciting thing you're going to hear at the end of this presentation is much of this work is being sustained. And then just to toot, we actually received a national award back in July for the work here, an ECHO award, a silver. So you're going to hear from Connie and Gary, and they have wonderful things to tell you. And I thank you for your support over these last 7 years.
Thank you, Susan.
Good morning, and thank you for the opportunity to be here. I am Connie Windham, the current project director, and with me is Gary Ander, the former and first project director for the Alamance Alliance. We want to review for you this morning a little bit about the grant, but primarily about the outcomes and the impact of this work. I think most of you know that this is a 6-year grant from SAMHSA. We serve young children from birth to 6 years of age with mental health needs. We often refer to that as social-emotional needs, so we'll use both of those terms. DSS, of course, was the grantee. The grant was received in 2008, and as Susan mentioned, federal funding is ending at the end of September. Now, most of the time, I don't know about you guys, but grants I've been involved with before, typically, when that funding ends, services end. That is not the case with this grant. We made a very conscious decision at the very beginning of this grant to invest in those agencies' capacity, the agencies that were already here when this grant started and will be here when this grant ends, to be able to do this work. And that's really what we focused on. We are required by the grant to work on the individual level, meeting directly with children and families in services, on the community level, developing that infrastructure we will talk about in a minute, and also quite a bit of work on the state level, attempting to influence policy, funding, things like that, and also have provided quite a bit of technical assistance to other communities in North Carolina that are also focusing on early childhood mental health.
Thank you.
So it's really a pleasure to be here. We actually got an extra year as a no-cost extension, so it ended up being a 7-year grant. I appreciate the support that you have given to the grant over the years. Why did we apply for this grant initially? And it's so timely, given the discussions about JCPC and your mental health initiative that Commissioner Byrd talked about. We got this recognition that if we are to impact significant issues in our community, such as high school dropouts and juvenile crime and teen pregnancy and drug abuse, we can't wait until our children become teenagers to intervene. I remember having a conversation 15 years ago with the sheriff about the numbers of people that were incarcerated and that they had mental health issues. Clearly, when Susan talks about our foster care children being and us trying to keep them from falling into the river upstream, this is what we wanted to do, is intervene early. And we recognize that mental health plays this major role in success, not only in school, but in later life. And that Alamance County, 8 years ago, had very little to offer for young children's mental health. A lot of the work that we have done has been built on the work of the Harvard University Center on the Developing Child and its director, Jack Shawncroft. And, this quote at the bottom of this slide, "When we fail to provide children with what they need to build a strong foundation for healthy and productive lives, we put our future prosperity, Alamance County's future prosperity and security at risk." And so this is really about talking about return on investment of early investment in kids in our community, kids and families. So just a few facts here to help kind of set the stage for why this is such an important issue. We talked about what the percentages of people who are incarcerated who have mental illness and or substance abuse, and a lot of that's co-occurring. So 1 in 5 children birth to 18 has a diagnosable mental illness. I mean, this is pretty incredible. 75 to 80% of those children never get any mental health services. So, they start kindergarten way behind, not having the social emotional skills to be successful. 35% of children who have experienced maltreatment demonstrate clinical level problems, and that's, we're talking about that foster care population. And that by the time they're 17, 62% of those youth in foster care will exhibit both symptoms of mental health and trauma. And trauma is a huge issue here. And I'll talk about that in the next slide. Our report from kindergarten teachers say about 20% of children entering school don't have the necessary social emotional skills to be successful. But there's some good information about this too. Again, part of the major reason that we applied has to do with research that's been done. So this is all research based. This ACEs study, and I would recommend that you spend 5 minutes researching ACEs. ACEs is Adverse Childhood Experiences. Adverse Childhood Experiences. This is a huge study done by the Centers for Disease Control and by Kaiser Permanente, 17,000 participants. And what they found, if you look at, is these adverse childhood experiences interfere with early brain development. And early brain development in children, 85% of that happens in children between the ages of 1 and 3. So physical and sexual abuse or neglect, exposure to substance abuse, mental illness, especially maternal depression, domestic violence, criminal activity, loss or death of a parent, and extreme poverty. Those are the things that really create this environment for poor development, for poor social emotional development. If you look at this pyramid, people who have these adverse childhood experiences then go on to having social, emotional, and cognitive impairment. And then that next layer is adoption of health risk behaviors. And health risk behaviors is I'm trying to compensate. So I'm drinking lots of alcohol. I'm consuming drugs. I'm getting involved in sexual acting out or gambling, all those kind of activities that lead to negative outcomes. And then there's what is a result of that is disease and disability and social problems. And that last says early death. And if you have four of these, the correlation is if you have four of these symptoms, you're more likely to die 25 years earlier than the general public. And that's not just because of socio-emotional concerns. It's also heart disease and liver disease and cancers and those kind of things. But if you look on the right-hand side, a study, a Robert Wood Johnson study, came out just this summer. It's a 20-year study. There is a huge cohort of North Carolina kids involved in that. There are kids from three different states. And this tells you about what are the positive results if kids really do have great social-emotional skills in kindergarten. Well, they are actually four times more likely by the age of 25 to graduate from college. This is twice, and on this 5-point scale, there is this difference. And so twice as likely to attend a college degree in early childhood if they just says 1 point on the scale difference, on 1 point. So, you know, if you have 3 points, you're four times more likely. 54% more likely to earn a high school diploma. 46% more likely to have a full-time job at 25. Full-time job means you're paying into the system. You're not taking out of the system. And for every 1 point decrease in that scale, 67% higher chance of having been arrested and maybe incarcerated in our local jail system. 82% higher rate of recent marijuana usage and 82% chance of waiting in line for public housing. This is about return on investment. That's why we applied. And I'll have to say that I was not an expert on this early on in the process, but what I recognize is that this social emotional competence in really young children, I believe, is the single most important determinant of future adult success. That's return on investment. So Connie's going to talk to you about the actual effects of the grant.
Okay, so who we serve with this grant, well, I mentioned it's birth up to the age of 6. If you think about the social-emotional development of all children, 100% of children, 80% of them are going to be more or less developing as they should. Families, however, at that 80% could still benefit from education and supports, but for the most part are doing okay. The upper two categories demonstrate kids that are struggling already as very young children with challenging behaviors. The targeted section could be a child, for instance, where parents are just beginning to say, something's not right. Or maybe the grandparents are saying, gee, I don't think they're developing quite like they should. The upper 5 to 10% are those kids that we are required to serve through the SAMHSA grant, required to develop services that are clinical in nature, or we're talking about treatment. So essentially, 20% of the kids that we are going to serve, because SAMHSA requires we serve the top 10% and allows us to serve the next 10% using what's called preventive intervention services, and we'll talk about that in a minute. To put this in perspective, if you had a classroom of 20 children, you would expect that 4 of them are going to be struggling with challenging behaviors in either that center or that top category. So think about what that might be like and how that might impact a classroom setting. Okay, so when we were thinking about developing an early childhood mental health system of care, these are the central elements that need to be in place in order to have a fully functioning system of care. You need community awareness. You need people aware that social emotional health is important You need families paying attention to the development of their children. You need somebody helping those families identify kids that might need help. You need some screening and referral going on. You need mental health treatment. You need mental health consultation. That's one of the key indicators of a fully functioning community, is having experts on early childhood mental health. And you need those central family supports like case management, like parenting classes, home visiting services in place. You need the infrastructure elements over there and the services elements. Both are required with this grant that we developed. So the very first thing we did in 2009 was a needs assessment of the community and what we had in place. Whoops. Okay. So in 2008, this is what we had in place in Alamance County in all of those areas. Basically no infrastructure, very little services. We had one agency, that was the health department, that was actually using a screening tool to screen kids with social emotional health. We had a handful of clinicians, therapists in Alamance County that would see 4- and 5-year-olds. Not so much because they wanted to see 4- and 5-year-olds or that that was their area of expertise. They just recognized that kids needed something. We had one clinician in Alamance County, and that was at Crossroads seeing young children with sexual assault, that were sexual assault victims. Mental health consultation, we had one agency with a consultant that was Head Start. Head Start requires that you have mental health consultation and has for many, many years. We had a little bit more in family supports. The Partnership for Children had just started Incredible Years for Parents and just started Parents as Teachers, both of which are evidence-based programs. One is a parent skill parenting class. The other is a home visiting service. I think they had one staff person doing that. Okay, so now we want to look at 2015 and what we have in place in Alamance County. I'm not going to go through every single one of these, but as you can see, we've done a tremendous amount of work. Just a couple of highlights. We currently now have multiple people trained to be trainers to continue the training for agencies and the general community on early childhood mental health. We have 15 agencies, essentially all of our child serving agencies, screening kids that come in. We have DSS, who is doing universal trauma screening, not just with young children, but now with children of all ages. Since November, when that started, we've screened over 1,500 children. About 30% of those children screened positive and were referred on. Many other things going on. We now have trained over 60 clinicians in early childhood mental health, how to have a early childhood mental health assessment. We have 5 evidence-based treatments available in Alamance County now. I won't go through all those initials down there, but 5 specifically for young children. And when we're talking about treatment for young children, it is always dyadic treatment, the child and the parent, that the therapist works with together. We have 8 mental health consultants or experts in multiple settings, including our school system, child care centers, pediatric offices, child welfare, public health, and Head Start. That's pretty amazing. And we have a multitude of family support services, including Family Partners, which is a unique and new service in Alamance County. It's much like peer support that we've heard in other settings and that mental health currently provides for adults. It's people with lived experience who have navigated the system for their own child, who now work to help families. They are absolutely critical in terms of engaging families in the very beginning and helping keep them in treatment. So you can see a very robust system. This is unusual for communities. Really, we are probably one of the few in the nation that have this robust services for young children that can impact all of those other major issues we've talked about. So the overall impact for this community is that more children and families are receiving services and supports. We have served over 1,500 children and their families. We have a community now that's much more aware of the social emotional health and development. We have families who are beginning to learn how important social emotional health is for children. Screening, standard of practice, that's major change for our child serving systems. We have consultation available in multiple settings. Families and professionals expect evidence-based practices, those practices that have been proven to be effective. And the community knows how and where to refer young children with issues. We have governance bodies that are beginning to support early childhood initiatives, mental health professionals doing assessments and evidence-based treatments. We have routine training going on in the community. We have family partners that are valued. We have a child welfare system that is screening all children and parents with access to evidence-based training and supports. So my final comment is the work truly is never done. We would love to see a task force, a council, someone to continue to maintain a focus on early childhood mental health. This community, as I said, has an unusual system in place now that many, many communities do not have. With a little bit of effort, little bit of people paying attention, we can keep this going in Alamance County. As you well know, clinicians turn over constantly, new staff come in, all of that. Any questions?
Go ahead, Andy.
Yeah, what was the total of the SAMHSA grant?
The allocation was about $8
million. $8
million. Over now it's 7 years.
Okay. And being on the Partnership for Children, I went on here, it was just pulled up the Heckman equation. And for those that aren't familiar with that, Dr. Heckman is a professor of economics in Chicago. And he did an analysis of a preschool program, and it shows a 7% to 10% per year return on investment based on increased school and career achievement. So he did a study of kids in preschool to see on the long haul what happens. And I think that's just so important to keep that in mind. We do economic development grants and everything here. So we do need to keep the momentum of what's been put in place by all the agencies that have been involved with that grant, whatever that takes.
Thank you.
Well, I have a couple of questions. Strategy is, you know, Impact Alamance and this drive together, and that actually the networks and the outcomes that will develop will carry hopefully most of this work forward.
Connie, we've got other counties. I knew when I was in the General Assembly, other counties say, how do you get the collaboration that you get between the agencies and the county? They can't understand. So how do you get all these folks to sit down at the table and work together? And so we're blessed in that respect.
We are. And, you know, this community has been a system of care community for 10, 15 years. It really makes a difference when you're looking at complex social issues.
Yeah.
One system can't solve that stuff. You have to work together. So. Yeah.
Well, I was curious for the clinicians that provide services, and particularly providing services to families and with children that need these services that are indigent and can't pay, how are they paid?
All of the services are reimbursable through third-party reimbursement, so, you know, a Medicaid.
So it'd be Medicaid, yeah, Medicaid.
Yes.
And then are the families that serve as the peer support, are they paid or is that volunteer?
They're paid. And under our grant, I think some models probably have some volunteers.
So I wanted to ask the question that I asked Linda Jones when she presented this to the community council last week. So the people from SAMHSA, when they come and look at what happened in Alamance County with their millions of dollars of grant funding, how do they react? What kind of feedback do you get?
Let Susan respond to that. We had a federal site visit. We have multiple ones, and it's very, very thorough. In particular, they interview the actual families that receive services, as well as, you know, all the community agencies that also participate. We got a remarkably glowing report, which I contribute truly the success of this grant to the foundation of system of care that had already been in this community. We already had agencies working together and, you know, people working towards the same goal. I personally think that's one of the major reasons why it was so successful.
They called us rock stars.
They said they did. They were very pleased.
Any further questions or comments? I'm going to change gears on you. I just want to thank you. I know you're retiring in December, and I just want
September.
Thank you for your the hard work you've done over the years.
It's an extraordinary way to end a career with this kind of work. I think it's very impactful.
You'll be back doing something.
I'm sure. Thank you.
There'll be a board waiting for you, I'm sure.
Thank you. Next, we have, approval of capital fund expenditures. Brian Haygood, our assistant county manager. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, commissioners. We have two capital needs. We have an elevator at the Human Service Center that is inoperative, needs a drive replacement. We also have a HVAC unit at the Rudd Street EMS base that is going to need to be replaced before winter comes. Total cost of these two projects, we're asking be funded from the Capital Reserve Fund. Total cost will be $36,052.99. Current balance of the Capital Reserve Fund is $222,330.62. If you approve these funds, the new balance will be $186,277.63. We are working on four projects that were approved through the CIP with that money, so it's that money has a place to go, but these were unforeseen and have come up. So I'll be happy to field any questions.
Questions?
I have a question. What, how long do you expect that repair to the elevator to last, and what's the condition of the other elevator?
We have a maintenance contract with Otis, and Otis can be on the project after we give them approval today, probably within 10 days. I suspect that will take at least a week, at least 5 business days to repair. This is a Otis looked at both elevators, has estimated what we should do. The workings of both elevators are about 20 years old. We should plan to spend approximately $250,000 to renovate both elevators at Human Service Center. That's the long-term fix here. This is short-term, replacing the current broken piece. So we're looking at probably 15 to 20 business days to repair.
And one of them could possibly go out. The other one could go out too, right?
Yes, they're both. They both were.
That's what I was asking. Yeah. What's the long-term outlook for these elevators? And
they were both retrofitted apparently when the county took the property. I believe in 1995 or 96.
95 is.
So we've gotten about 20 years of service out of the work that was done then, which according to the elevator experts, that's about the most you can expect.
Average.
So moved.
Okay. There you go.
Talk it to death.
I think the judge has made a motion that that we approve.
Let's go ahead and fix this elevator.
I'll second the motion. I'm not opposed to it. I just want to make sure we're spending our money wisely and not, you know, again, during good money.
We have a second. Any further comments?
I have confidence in the assistant manager. I don't have to worry about whether it's going to work or not.
Hearing no further comments or questions, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you, Brian.
Thank you.
All right. Next, budget amendment finance. So, welcome.
Thank you. Budget amendment is requested for accounting purposes. As you know, the state recently started collecting vehicle taxes for us. They collect a fee, and they've been sending us a net check. That's reflected in our current budget. What we'd like to do is to amend the budget to show the gross revenues from the vehicle tax collections and the fees separately. This is more clearly indicated by generally accepted accounting principles, and we would like to make that budget amendment tonight.
Moving from one line item to another, basically, or starting another.
Yeah.
Line. So moved.
Yeah. Second.
Motion. We have a motion. Second. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. County manager's report.
I will be brief. Just
so me. I don't believe that.
I'm sorry, got tripped up. Remind you, our county strategic planning meeting is this Thursday at 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. at the Grand Oaks Room at ARMC. So we will be there, and then we'll break for lunch and go over to David Carter's church for the 911 celebration. well, remembrance at that point. But that is this Thursday from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. Also, just wanted to mention, Chairman Engel was recently appointed chairman, or representative for District 11 on the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners. So that was done at the last annual meeting. So congratulations to Chairman Engel. And I did want to mention this coming Friday, September 11th at 6:30 p.m. At People's Memorial Church on Highway 87. The Men of Steel, who our good friend Don Wilson was very involved in, will be honoring Don at that meeting. And I would like to just wanted to mention that, and if you're interested in going, would love for you to be there.
Any further?
No, sir.
Questions?
The meeting on Thursdays, that's in a separate building on the ARMC campus, the Grand Oak Center. It's right
across from the Cancer Center.
Yeah, it's kind of across. It's right on the corner of Grand Oaks Boulevard in that entrance to the hospital off of Grand Oaks Boulevard.
All right.
Where
the
clinic is.
Yes, right there at the clinic.
Yes, where the...
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
The county
county's clinic.
Oh, yeah. Same building as the county's clinic, county. Right.
Yeah. All right. We come to the commissioner's comments. I'll ask if any comments. I've got a couple things, Bob.
You better hurry up. It's going to leave.
No, judge's time.
I won't be able to attend that strategic meeting Friday after listening to all of this mental health conversation today. I'm calling my psychiatrist to see if I can get an appointment.
Judge, we'll miss you, Judge. What's up?
Hope they can work that out.
I'm sure I'll miss a lot.
Any further comments? All right. Well, I've got a couple of things. This is a special one here, and I'm gonna go down to the podium to take care of this.
Oh, wait.
Can we get by this way?
Yeah,
this way.
Yeah. Bob
said, it's always gratifying when you have an employee that endeavors to work hard to improve themselves. And we have a young lady here that has just completed her International Institute of Municipal Clerks. Let me read this. Dear Tori Frank, on behalf of the Board of Directors of the International Institute of Municipal Clerks, it's my pleasure to inform you that you've been awarded the International Institute of Municipal Clerks designation of Certified Municipal Clerk. Included in this package is your hard-earned CMC certificate, which I'm going to present to you. As you're heading up, I'm going to keep talking. We hope you wear it proudly. IIMC grants the CMC designation only to those municipal clerks who complete demanding education requirements and who have a record of significant contributions to their local government, their community, and their state. In light of the speed and drastic nature of these have changed these days, lifelong learning is not only desirable, it is necessary for all in local government to keep pace with growing demands and changing needs of the citizens we serve. We applaud your educational accomplishments and achievement of this milestone and congratulate you on your personal pursuit of professional excellence. And it's signed Monica Simmons, who is the president. That's really nice. Thank you. And thank you for your hard work.
Tori had to work hard to earn that and learn how to keep commissioners straight.
This is well earned, I can assure you, buddy. One other short item of business. I would like, by consensus, the issue on Tony Cox. I know in the minutes, in the July 20th minutes, it stated that he was prevented, banned from speaking for 6 months because of things said about commissioners. Actually, that was only a part of it. The rest of it was there were statements being made about private citizens in this county. If you would go back and look at it, and we need to certainly discourage that during public speaking. But with that being said, it's been three meetings, and maybe, in my opinion, my humble opinion, 6 months might have been a little long. And so by consensus, I'm just asking this board that we rescind the remainder of that 6 months, provided that Mr. Cox adheres to the procedural requirements governing public speaking set forth by the Board of Commissioners. And if I have that consensus, then I'd, and I see nodding yes from all of our commissioners, and I just asked either Mr. Albright or one of you send the letter to him.
I'll send him a letter.
Thank you, sir. And we're going to give it a try. And I think when it's petitioning your government and public speaking, it's one of the most important things that you can do. And certainly, we need to encourage that. And if there's any way we can work to see that things are done properly, we need to do that. So thank you, board. For agreeing with it. Any other comments from commissioners? Hearing none, meeting is adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building, located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m., and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioner's website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel, beginning at 10 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of the commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information on the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.